Thank you everyone for coming to this talk organized by the Global Mobility Project at Ohio State, one of the new pilot projects of the Humanities and Arts Discovery Theme. And we are very grateful for the funding that we have received from the college to organize this event, but also for this particular talk, I do want to acknowledge the support that we have received from the Office of International Affairs to bring to campus Peter Gatrell from Manchester University, and I'm going to give you Peter's bio in a second. I just want to talk very briefly about what we're doing at this semester and to also urge you to explore our website, which if you Google OSU Global Mobility, you will find us. We also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and we're organizing a series of talks, film screenings, community events. We also are launching a new grants program, and you can find all of this information there. And today we're very pleased to welcome Peter Gatrell at OSU because we're very pleased that he so generously agreed to schedule him to do a variety of different activities during his time on campus. In addition to giving this talk, he's also going to participate in a discussion of a film that we're screening tomorrow, Fire at Sea, 7 p.m. at the Wexner, Wexner Center for the Arts. And if you wanted to join us for that event, please do. And he's also meeting with graduate students during his visit here. He's visiting the Seminar for Russian, Eastern European, and Eurasian History, and participating in the discussion with graduate students there. So we have really occupied him in a number of activities, including a podcast that we're going to record tomorrow. So we are very, very grateful for his generous attitude to our multiple requests for his time. Peter began his career as an economic and social historian of Russia. He's the author of A Whole Empire Walking, Refugees in Russia During World War I, published by Indiana University Press, which won a number of very prestigious awards in the Eastern European and Russian fields. And currently, from a historian of Russia, he has taken a more comparative European and global perspective on the issue of displacement, state building, and social identity. And he has published a number of works that place refugees in Europe in a bigger context. One is Free World, the Campaign to Save the World's Refugees, 1956 to 1963. And most recently, his book, The Making of the Modern Refugee. Peter is also currently completing a monograph on the history of Europe since 1945 with a focus on migration in and to Europe, a monograph I will definitely use in my teaching since I'm teaching a number of classes on modern Europe through the prism of migration, and I think it will be a very, very helpful book that will help us contextualize these bigger trends in the European context. I want to also acknowledge that we are live streaming this lecture together with our colleagues at Purdue University's Human Rights Program. They approached us asking us whether we could live stream this event because on their end they have a similar class to the one that I brought here with me. What you see here, guys, is some of my students in a 4,000 level class on migration in modern Europe. At Purdue, they have a similar class, History 491, Refugees, Displacement, and Statelessness. And they also assigned Peter's book, the Making of the Modern Refugee, so that was a perfect occasion to bring those two events together. So we can say hello to our friends from Purdue. They're watching on our Facebook page in a computer lab. So we will see how this experiment turns out. But without further ado, I want to ask you to welcome Peter Gatrell, who is going to talk on...
Hey, Laura, thanks very, very much for that introduction and for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be at Ohio State, where there are lots of people doing work that I admire and have learned a great deal from. And I should say hello to Purdue people, and I also want to thank Chris Adams for making the arrangements for travel and so forth so smooth. Now, this is something in the nature of an experiment. I'm trying to think through what the contours of something called refugee history might look like. So in a way, you and people at Purdue are a kind of guinea pig on which I'm trying out this project. And my starting point is a kind of ethical question about the duties or the responsibilities of the historian of refugees in the very moment in which we're now living. And if I think about the kind of responsibility that I assume in writing about refugees, as someone who is not himself a refugee, I want to try and think through the question about a refugee and how refugees become. That's partly, of course, a question about what causes displacement. But it's also about a broader set of questions about how refugees become something of a problem, and I'm using scare quotes here, amenable to a solution. What is it that's going on in the 20th century that turns refugees into a problem? But I think we could go beyond this and think about the ways in which much of the contemporary discourse is around the idea of an emergency, a current emergency, particularly in Europe, a refugee crisis, as it's often called. And I want to probe and challenge the idea that the world in which we are living faces an unprecedented crisis. And the best way that a historian can do this is to look at what I'm calling the precedence of the unprecedented. In other words, if we turn our attention to moments in 20th century world history, such as after the two world wars, there is abundant evidence of what one might call refugee crises at other times and in other sites of displacement. So that raises, obviously, the question about how did refugees in other times and places become a problem and were confronted by solutions, often of not of their own devising. The other thing that's very much on my mind at the moment is what I think is a troubling preoccupation with Europe. That's not to minimize what is happening in Europe in the second decade of the new millennium, but it is to remind ourselves that this is a very parochial approach, since there are plenty of instances of refugees who never show up anywhere near the continent of Europe. If we think of sub-Saharan Africa, if we think of parts of the Far East and the Middle East, there's something terribly parochial about the occupation with Europe as the headline-grabbing centre of attention. And to pursue that a little bit further, I think one could also say that the duty of the historian is to attend to situations that have become crises of enduring importance, long-lasting episodes of displacement. We can think most obviously of Palestinian refugees in the Middle East, but we might also think of West Africa and Sahrawi refugees. In Burma, stroke Myanmar, we can think of Rohingya. And if you like to think about Europe, you might also attend to what has happened over a 40-year period since the war over the island of Cyprus in the Mediterranean, about which there are ongoing and quite recent attempts to resolve that crisis. So I think all this is a way of trying to stretch the chronological as well as the geographical focus in thinking about refugees in history. But what I want to try and work through in this presentation is the question as to whether, in addition to multiplying instances of refugees being displaced, of which there are numerous instances, is it possible that we can go beyond this and to say there is a field or a subject of study called refugee history? And therefore, we can all, I imagine, think of different sites and situations, different actors, and I'll say more about that in a moment, different obstacles, or if you like, constraints that refugees encounter, different views, different perspectives, different technologies, different objects, different images. But all these circulate in different contexts, historical contexts. But is it possible that we can imagine a concept or a conceptualization which enables us to think about these within a single kind of analytic frame? And I'll say more about this in a moment, but I'm taking my cue from a Russian term that is now a century old, which translates best as refugeedom. And the interpretation I want to suggest to you is that we can think of this notion of refugeedom as a kind of combination of matrix of interlocking relations and practices with concrete effects. Now that sounds, in the way I've just put it, terribly abstract. I want to kind of put it in less abstract forms as I go through the talk, but just as it were, offer you as a kind of headline the suggestion that that is what I'm trying to grapple with. I'm not suggesting that I've found a complete set of answers, but that's the problem that I'm trying to think my way through. Now, of course, another way of thinking about this is to imagine me 20 or 30 or even 40 years younger, which I sometimes do when I'm thinking about the destination that I've travelled and where I've ended up. And I wanted to just lay out a few what might seem very straightforward parameters, if you like. And the best way in which I can think about where I am now is to say that if you're writing about the history of refugees, you're writing about something beyond refugees. You're writing, it's not just about refugees. That may seem very obvious to some of you, but I think it's something that has only gradually dawned upon me as I've done research and taught the subject. So there are multiple relationships involved. First and foremost, I think, we have to think about the state, or states. Partly because states produce refugees, but also, I would argue, because refugees produce states. Now, what I have in mind is, of course, things that will be probably evident to you, that there are conflicts, wars, civil wars, that produce refugees. There are revolutionary regimes that produce refugees. Sometimes there are states that are yet to be born that are producing refugees or are grappling with the consequences of population displacement. But without going into too much detail now about the relationship between war or wars and the production of refugees, what I'd like to insist upon is that it's a process that works both ways. In other words, that we can think of refugees not just as the byproduct of conflict, but also as helping to foster a sense of stateness, or to help states imagine themselves as polities, even if they are yet to take a concrete form. And we can talk more about this in Q&A if you wish. But then, beyond the state, we have to think of non-state actors as well. And these include intergovernmental organizations and non-governmental organizations. And anyone who works at all on the topic of population displacement soon becomes aware that in addition to states, from the epoch of the First World War aftermath, you have institutions, organizations such as the League of Nations. After the Second World War, you have a series of organizations which culminate in 1950-51 in the inauguration of the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, UNHCR. And these intergovernmental organizations don't just happen, they are created, and they need personnel, they need a staff, as well as an agenda. So you cannot write the history of refugees without factoring in the history and purpose and activity of institutions like the League of Nations or UNHCR. But then the world of displaced people is also a world activated by, driven by non-governmental organizations that have their own purpose, their own history, their own agenda, their own staff, and which engage a whole panoply of personnel, which may be professionally qualified people, lawyers, social workers, statisticians, medical personnel, and so forth. And those organizations interact with each other and not just with refugees. So one can imagine all kinds of ambitions that collide, turf wars, if you like, between one NGO and another. So rivalries matter as well as the actions that any one NGO pursues. Then, of course, there are people who are not part of these institutions, but who are encountering refugees, not least as host populations. As refugees move from one place to another, obviously they come into contact with host populations. And that sets up a whole slew of questions around the economic status of the host populations, what is their relationship economically as well as socially to the newcomers, and the relationship between what may be people of different ethnicity, how do they interact with the newcomers. And then, of course, there are less obvious kinds of relationships, including between those who stay behind. When a refugee population moves, it is clearly in some kind of dynamic interrelationship with people who either could not or did not move. So that is also part of the historical framework that one has to take into account. And then there are other refugees. As a refugee population moves, it encounters people who've gone before very often. Migrants or others who've created diasporic populations. And as refugees end up in a new place, oftentimes you find an encounter with people who have been already in place, in a new place, maybe a generation or even longer before. So we're dealing with this multiple set of relationships, and that of course makes things very complicated to disentangle these relationships. And of course, the job of the historian is, amongst other things, to contextualize how those different relationships play out over time. But then, if you think about this as a relational question, what refugee history is as a relational question, then there are other relations. There are relations of space. That the whole notion of displacement raises questions about where it is that refugees end up. And sometimes they end up in places of incarceration, or if you like, protection, though often protection is something of a misnomer, such as refugee camps. But refugee camps are not the only history of refugees who settle temporarily or on a longer term basis. There are other transit centres, holding centres, and many refugees never set foot inside or stay for very long inside a refugee camp. But when I think of camps or other settlements, I'm thinking about places that aren't just there, but places that are fashioned and refashioned by the presence of refugees. So there's something, again, dynamic about the presence and action of refugees. That places are made and remade. Sometimes the place did not exist before. Sometimes the place is transformed by the presence of refugees. And then lastly, as I think about this relational aspect of the question, there's the question of temporal relationships. In other words, how one thinks of oneself in relation to one's past, and the ways in which refugees themselves can fashion a sense of their past, that refugees themselves are historians of their own predicament. And that's a fascinating question too, because it then raises all sorts of questions in turn about who is the refugee historian? Who speaks? Who speaks louder? Whose voice counts for more than other potential authors? And who are they writing for? Whose views are believed? Who gets credence in this situation? And who is acknowledged And I put on the presentation one way of thinking about this, which I came across in reading a book by Julianne Hammer on displaced Palestinians, where she quotes a young Palestinian man, a teenager or young in his young 20s, who told her that my mother told us about Palestine, but she didn't know the plot. In other words, that there was a kind of history that I learned at my mother's knee, but that my mother wasn't sufficiently educated or astute or of the right gender to tell us about the plots that turn this into a history on which basis I am going to act. Okay? That sense of ownership, of claim to authority is something that one has to take into account as well. I'm also wanting to suggest to you that part of the historical necessity is to think about the way in which displacement is represented in cultural terms. So some of you I know will be fairly familiar with the idea of an iconography of displacement. In other words, images that speak to us about refugees. Very often these are cultural representations that refugees themselves may have to negotiate, but do not themselves control. Oftentimes, these are gendered in specific sorts of ways to reinforce the sense that refugees are people who not only suffer, but suffer in ways that demonstrate an incapacity. That they have needs, and those needs must be addressed by someone other than themselves. And there's much work, great work done by anthropologists and cultural theorists that draw attention to the idea of images that don't just exist but are reproduced endlessly, that suggest a kind of anonymous figure of the refugee, who doesn't belong to any particular context or historical situation but is dehistoricized. The refugee who is, I sometimes think of this as a like a cork bobbing on the water, bobbing on the ocean. The God can't control their movement, but is just buffeted from one place to another. Flotsam and jetsam, if you like. Now, I give you two examples of what I'm trying to convey here. The image on the left is literally model refugees. That's to say, you can buy a plastic series of individual elements, a body, an outfit, a cart, as part of your field of battle. Some astute entrepreneur who's selling figures for the battlefield and armaments, tanks, as well as soldiers in uniform, decided that no modern battlefield scenario is complete without locating a refugee group as part of that scenario. So has marketed this object, or series of objects, a cluster of refugees. And I think it's now, if you buy it, you buy a grey plastic. You have to colour it yourself. I have bought it. I have not coloured it. I was so irritated when I bought this that I had to do the hard work of assembling it and coloring it. It's sitting in a kind of box. But I have my model refugees. But from the business website, you can see that this is I suspect what this is. It's someone's imagination of the Balkans, of the breakup of Yugoslavia in the 1990s. And has decided that what I will do is to have a family as a kind of wailing female figure on the right-hand side. And where is this family destined for? Who are they? Where are they from? It doesn't matter, because we've got a kind of authentic presence of refugees on our battlefield scenario now. The right image is, in its own ways, equally troubling. It's also lacking in historical content. It's an image of a young child, female. It appeared in a magazine, British political magazine, in 1958, when a group of conservative politicians in the UK decided that they wanted to orchestrate a campaign to save the world's refugees. And they chose, as the cover of this political broadsheet, this political magazine, this image. And I imagine they did so with some thought, but not with too much thought. They wanted something to encapsulate the idea of someone who was helpless and bedraggled. But it doesn't need me to, I think, point to some of the deeply troubling aspects of this image. So this girl is on what looks like wooden planks. Is this a boat of some kind, or is it a floor of a different kind? Is she asleep? Is she dead? Has she rested in this pose with a dress that's virtually to her waist? Or has some photographer decided that this is the best way to draw attention to her desperation? And there are all sorts of troubling aspects about this kind of image. I turned the page of the magazine, and I nearly fell off my chair because the next image inside is an advert for a package holiday. It's 1958, package tourism was just getting going. And here's a picture of two people, it's not a photograph, it's a drawing, of man and woman, also half naked, except that he's got swimming trunks on and she's got a bikini, and they're lying on the beach, Greece, I suppose. And this is an advert for travel to some kind of happy destination. And the juxtaposition of someone who was lying on her back without any kind of context or explanation, advertising desperation, and the next image, which is advertising hedonism, pleasure, was a kind of, I'm sure, not at all deliberate, but it made me sit up and just wonder what was going on. So the iconography of displacement is incredibly rich and powerful, but sometimes deeply troubling. Now, the campaign that was launched in 1958 became known as World Refugee Year, which was a big, big project, especially in the UK, USA, Canada, and other parts of the white Commonwealth, not just Canada, but Australia, New Zealand, but also parts of continental Europe, including Greece. And I wanted to share this image with you as well, partly because boats and waves and the idea of an ocean that can destroy boats and people is kind of being alluded to in this stamp. So you've got actually two stamps, unusually, for this campaign. Lots of countries that participate issued stamps. Greece issued two. A lower value stamp on the left, which shows the boat in distress. But a lighthouse holding up hope of deliverance. And on the right, is the stamp that they issued simultaneously with a higher value, this is Greek drachma, which shows the calm and the boat making its way safely into a Greek harbour, with the image of the lighthouse flare now being replaced by a comfortable image of a rainbow. And I call this humanitarianism without the human, because one of the things about this is that there is no human figure to be seen. It's about some kind of idealized vision of Greece as a point of safety, of deliverance. But without any humans, and without any indication of where this boat is from being presented. Okay, now let me show you a couple of images. It's time to do a bit more hard work and to think about the history of refugees in relation to the history of refugee regimes. And refugee regimes are created once one has a figure of a refugee around which to orchestrate one's activities. And there can be, and in the literature, there is a wide-ranging sense of what constitutes a refugee regime. So a refugee regime, you must think of as not just an organisation, but that's part of it, but the rules that govern that organisation and its interaction with refugees and other agencies. And the point I want to insist upon is that to engage in refugee history is to recognise that there is a history to the choices made about what kind of refugee regime is created. In other words, the refugee regime, the regime that tries to solve the refugee question or the refugee problem, is not necessarily the same at different points in time. So there is a regime that takes shape after the First World War with a small office of the League of Nations at its heart, which determines that it will assist refugees of a particular kind, predominantly Russians who fled after the revolution of 1917, and Armenians, most of whom have not only survived the genocide of 1915, but have made their way to places of safety and are trying to get out to some other part of the world. So it recognises obligation towards specific groups of refugees. But the League of Nations regime of a post-1918 form does not formally recognise any responsibility internationally towards refugees who are created by diplomats. So Lausanne in 1923, the agreement in Lausanne is about a population exchange between Greeks in Turkey, the ex-Ottoman Empire, and Turks of Muslim faith who are in Greece who are to be transferred to Turkey. Well, if there's a diplomatic population exchange, there are no refugees because the people concerned will simply end up in their home. Greeks will live with Greeks and Turks live with Turks. And this wasn't formally recognised as a situation in which the office of the High Commissioner under the Norwegian explorer Nansen had any responsibility, direct responsibility. But of course, the League of Nations ended up picking up some of the pieces with this by creating the Refugee Resettlement Commission in Greece. So you end up with a kind of odd situation where the formal institutions handle the needs of Russian and Armenian refugees, but at the same time another league body is trying to assist refugees from the Lausanne Agreement with things like loans and other kinds of assistance. My point is that there's always a choice and always a kind of selectivity at work, and that selectivity is also in evidence after the Second World War, because the Second World War in Europe is a situation where there's an enormous displacement of population because Hitler has brought forced labourers to work in the Nazi war economy during the war, and with Germany's defeat, they are a problem. What is to be done with these millions of forced labourers, now called displaced persons? And the United Nations, which is an embryonic organisation, begins to recognise that it has a responsibility towards them. Meanwhile, the other diplomatically created population displacement is those ethnic Germans who are forcibly removed from Czechoslovakia and Poland primarily and are forced to move into defeated Germany, known as expellees, the Vertriebenen. And the institutions that are devised to assist DPs do not apply to expellees. So again, you have population space with political choices about whom to assist and whom to exclude from your institutional arrangement. And those who become refugees under the 1951 convention, which still is in operation today, are accorded specific kinds of rights, chief amongst which is the right not to be returned to the country that has persecuted. So we end up in a situation where there is an international refugee regime that is selective. but it's selective in another sense too, which is that there are millions of refugees in other parts of the world for whom either no international provisions made or specific provisions made. Palestinian refugees do not come within the United Nations Convention. They're not part of the post-war arrangements that apply in Europe. So a special institution called the United Nations Relief and Works Administration is created for them. More to the point, what happens when refugees are displaced in Korea? What happens when refugees are displaced in South Asia following the partition of India in 1947? The United Nations does not have a direct responsibility towards them. So you've got to imagine that, again, choices are being made whom to assist and how, and whom to entrust to other forms of assistance. So the new governments of India and Pakistan devise their own arrangements to support refugees, but they're not part of the United Nations arrangement. Is there, you might then ask, a new set of regime in operation now? There are plenty of people who say that the United Nations Convention of 1951 was of its specific time and place and has outlived its rationale. It must be either abolished or replaced with something else. We can talk about this in Q&A. All I want to say at this stage is that we do seem to be at a kind of conjuncture that has elements of distinctiveness, what I call a perfect storm in Europe, because of the assault on notions of protection, the ideas of deterrence, the idea of forcing refugees, particularly Syrians, to return under the EU deal to Turkey and risk being sent back across the border into Syria. That assault on protection, as I'm calling it, is also evident in other contexts as well. Think of the refugee camps in Kenya, refugees being expected to go back to Somalia, Myanmar, what's happening to the Rohingya refugees in Myanmar and Burma, Pakistan, what's happening to Afghan refugees being expected to return to Afghanistan. The idea of protection seems to be losing the kind of power that it had, except that the protection that we now think is at risk was always a partial protection in the first place because of this selectivity that I've made something of. Okay, so just briefly on the idea or concept of refugeedom. So we go back a century, or a century plus 2 years, so 1915, you begin to find in the Russian literature a massive refugee movement because the Germans, Austrians have invaded and civilians are being forced from their homes or have fled into the Russian interior, and Russian public discourse creates this new term, what I'm calling refugee. And they're trying to do this to understand the novelty of the situation they're confronting. This is another kind of unprecedented moment. How can we make sense, not just of the numbers or the ethnicity, because these are multi-ethnic populations, not just Russians by any means, Jews, Latvians, Lithuanians, Poles, and others, but what is it doing to society? What are the political and social consequences of this? So the concept that is created is a novel concept of refugeedom. And I think that what the purpose was to try and understand this in relation to what has become of the character, what has become of the person who has been displaced. That person's status, that person's psychology, certainly what the Russians call their character, had changed. How do we understand it? How do we address it? What does it imply for social order or social disorder? Is this a calamitous thing, process that we now have to address? But what I'm trying to do is to try and think beyond this particular moment of 1915-16 to suggest that this is a term. The power relations involved in this term, which are asymmetrical power relations, can we use that term to help us think through displacement in other places and other times, without essentializing the refugee, without suggesting there is a kind of universal, timeless person called the refugee. I don't want to suggest that for a moment. So can we, as it were, have a non-essentialized understanding of refugees within this matrix of power relations called refugee? And can we do it in a way that suggests not something out of time or out of place, but something that's dynamic rather than static? And what I want to suggest is that we can do this, we can think of the power relations in which refugees may have hold few of the cards, but we can also think not only of constraints, but how refugees navigate, how they negotiate, how they exercise a degree of agency within them. And that's very exciting, to be able to think beyond the as it were, condition of refugeedom, think about how refugees help to find their way around it. But I also think it's important to recognise that one of the things that's going on is a situation of labelling, of categorisation. That also has a history. When people talk about refugees, historically, they're entering into a situation where, again, choices are at work about what distinguishes a refugee from an economic migrant, what distinguishes a refugee from a displaced person, so on and so forth. And I call this the process that the philosopher Ian Hacking has described as making up people. So you're fashioning a person and a category at the same time. For Hacking, it's a question of identity. You're not just sort of creating a label, but the label itself helps to create an identity that this person or these people have. Which then raises questions in turn. Who does the creation? Who does the labeling? Who does the categorization? And what's at stake? How do you find your way around that if your label's a refugee? Coming back to some very specific moment, we're at the end, very nearly, of the Second World War. And a very astute social worker called Herta Kraus, who was German by birth, but he spent a lot of her working life as a social worker in the United States, was a Quaker, an American Quaker. And she wrestles with this question of how do we begin to distinguish between these different people who are on the move at the end of the Second World War. And she draws up a classification standard, as she describes it, for UNRWA. UNRWA is the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration. So it's a body established by the United Nations in 1943 to work out what happens at the end of the war, including what happens to all these people who are on the move. And I haven't got time to take you through all the labels in turn, but you can just see how there's an almost endless list of people who are meant to be distinguished one from the other. So it's not just a question of displaced persons or refugees, but there are people who are fugitives, there are people who've been deported, or even extruded and intruded persons before we get anywhere near prisoners of war. So I simply give you this as a kind of moment when what Pierre Bourdieu calls the classification issue, or the classification struggle, reaches a kind of crescendo. How do you differentiate one person from another? And remember, we're just talking about notions of displacement. We haven't got anywhere near ethnicity, or gender, age, or occupation, or other kinds of markers of identity. UNRWA also, it's rather a poor image to look through, which is why I've given one or two points on the right-hand side. What UNRWA did was to devise a flow chart. So you now have a situation in which officials are beginning to design how you can take refugees through the process of resolving their displacement. So this is an assembly centre for DPs. So these are displaced people. Bear in mind, many of them, not all of them by any means, a minority rather than the majority, do not wish to return to their homes in Poland or Soviet Ukraine or the Baltic, either out of aversion to communism or because the Baltic states have been incorporated into the Soviet Union at the start of the Second World War and do not wish to return to homes that are now under a different administration. But the point about this flowchart is that you have a very kind of technocratic approach to how people move from one stage to another. So admission control sounds like something out of a space, in a command center. You verify their nationality, and then you await disposal. A disposal, as if this kind of displaced population is kind of garbage that has to be sifted so that you can decide, you know, what is recyclable. In other words, what is repatriable and what is not. But I've said all this in terms of the fact that categories have consequences. I haven't got time to look at this in any detail, but I did want to suggest that this process of distinguishing refugees is something active. The International Refugee Organization, which takes over from UNRWA in 1947, has its own kind of take on how you can distinguish one kind of displaced person from another. And it's saying that you've got political refugees, well, we recognize these as people who fear persecution, do not want to return to the Soviet bloc, so to speak, but not all DPs fall into that category. There may be people who invoke political reasons as a cloak for their search for a better life. So the International Refugee Organization is beginning to think its way through. Okay, there are refugees, but are there also economic migrants? Or are these people who pass themselves off as political refugees, and we should think of them as a new kind of category of economic dissident? In other words, people who don't like socialism. I'm going to skip this slide for reasons of time. The slides can be made available very easily afterwards. I just want to draw your attention to the fact that there is a convention, 1951 convention, which has a very clear and explicit notion of who is the refugee to be recognized as a refugee. You have to be able to demonstrate as an individual that you've been persecuted on various grounds. But that was contested. You have other bodies, such as church groups, the World Council of Churches, which say, no, this is far too exclusionary. What about people who think of themselves as having a right to be regarded as a refugee on economic grounds? That may be economic oppression. So playing with this idea of economic reasons having all sorts of different aspects to them. So again, political choices, political debates, in operation. Then, if we're thinking about how you imagine the refugee in certain situations, you have to understand that there's not only a legal bureaucratic sense in which this operates, but also a vernacular sense that refugees themselves engage with the labels. Partition of India, some refugees who've moved from India to Pakistan, or vice versa, in this case from Pakistan to India, identify as believers in self-help. We're not dependent. We're Purushati. We believe in self-help, so we don't want handouts. And they distinguish themselves from the refugee, who is the dependent, the abject figure. So these are refugees making those distinctions themselves. These are not bureaucratic labels, these are refugees' vernacular. But then others, as an example of Cyprus in 1974, which I rather like, where refugees play upon, seize the label, and turn it to their economic advantage. So they trade as business people, as a refugee taxi service, or opening stores, advertising their product as refugee kebabs. So here, the refugee label is not something to be ashamed of, it's something to capitalize upon. Or, I'll skip the second bullet point and look at the third, where you've got a kind of refugee wit that a Russian woman creates a small pamphlet which she calls the DP alphabet, the Diplomatическая Азбука. And you can read how she goes through letters of the alphabet and suggests what the alphabet looks like for a DP, a Russian DP. The letter E stands for the Russian word yetash, the verb to go. But she says, nowhere. The letter N stands for нет документов, no documents. S stands for rumours, for the Russian word slukhi, the most panic-inducing of which travel at 300,000 kilometres per second. I mean, how you read this is up to you. The way I read it is a kind of playfulness that refugees, in this instance, in a camp in 1945, go beyond the situation of incarceration as one of abject suffering and denial, to think of themselves as having a kind of playfulness to their vocabulary, or, if you like, the desperation is leavened by a kind of wit. Or if you want an image, a friend of mine, Lithuanian scholar Thomas Balkalis, pointed me in the direction of this cartoon from 1946. So this is a Lithuanian group in a DP camp. And I don't know whether you can make it out, but this is a crowd in a confined space. At the top is the professor in a barrel who is struggling to read a book in the midst of all this hubbub underneath. You have the Lithuanian women who are looking at a choice cut of meat and an animal, a cow or a bull, whose eyes are open as the butcher holds onto the cleaver about to cut his head in two. Or people dancing, people playing chess, or a couple half undressed and a peeping Tom peeping through the curtain. I mean, I'm not asking you to love this image, but what I am asking you to do is to accept the inventiveness of refugees in situations that might otherwise be regarded as desperate. So when I move towards the end, it's rather an odd thing to do for a historian to come towards the end of a presentation by thinking about sources, because we always think of sources early on, except that when I talk to my students, particularly graduate students, it's not always the sources that we begin with. You want to think about the question and then think what the sources are that are appropriate. So I offer you a few thoughts along these lines, which is that there is no oral testimony to speak of from large chunks of the 20th century. There are projects, certainly great projects, are ongoing amongst partition scholars to try and interview survivors of 1947, who are obviously very elderly now. But what we're left with is very often archives produced not by refugees themselves, but by agencies that claim to assist. So the archives of institutions, of non-governmental organizations in particular, are incredibly rich, and they are a way of thinking through this relationship between refugees and non-refugees. If I had to rise to the challenge of saying, what happens when refugee voices cannot be heard because you can't go back in time and interview Russian refugees in 1915, or you can't interview refugees immediately after the Second World War in European DP camps? No, you can't. But you can recognize that refugees are active petitioners of bodies such as the League of Nations, or UNHCR, or its predecessor bodies, in which they are expressing not just their needs, but their wishes. So they're making active claims for recognition, active claims for them to be heard. But also, and always in a partial sense, there are other refugees who don't speak or can't write petitions. And you've got ultimately refugees who choose or are forced to remain silent, just as refugees can sew their lips as a form of protest in today's detention centres. But what I like about this possibility is that you can explore the letters and the petitions of refugees that are archived and show how refugees are active participants, what I call managing their management, engaging with institutions. And there is beyond this text a material culture of another textual kind, commemorative objects, memory books that not just Jewish refugees survivors of the Holocaust, Palestinian refugees, Armenian refugees, refugees in parts of the Balkans in more recent past have created, or even memory boats. I'll give you an example of that in a moment, which is we can think of as not just objects of an inert kind, but objects that have a political purpose, that are interventions in debates and claims around dispossession and potential restitution. A memory boat is an example from East Asia, from Vietnamese so-called boat people who returned to an island in Indonesia called a galang and have invested in the creation of a boat with the figure of the Virgin Mary designed to, as it were, draw attention to the kind of deliverance that they have had from their displacement, from their ordeal by boat. Or what I call the memory stick left behind by a Belgian refugee called Richard Wibbel, who engraved his walking stick as he was forced as a Belgian refugee by virtue of the German invasion of Belgium into France. And as he went from village to village, behaved rather like an early modern pilgrim and carved the name of each village on his successive stages of his journey. So there's this material record that even if one can't go back in time and interview the Richard Wibbel, one can at least see something of the meaning that he ascribed to his journey of displacement. So what I would do by way of summary, this is the penultimate, not the final slide, is ask what happens when we talk about refugees. And I would summarise my thoughts at the moment as saying that refugee history is about how refugees were made by non-refugees, a problem, that's to say, of being a refugee, but how they also made themselves, and how they navigated these asymmetric power relationships, and sometimes, not always, were able to challenge the reductive assumptions about who they are, about the quality of the refugee, or the needs of the refugee. How in constituting refugeedom, they were also able to draw attention to their wishes, to their capabilities, and not just their abject condition. But if you don't like refugeedom, but you want another term to hold on to, we can come back to this notion of displacement. Displacement as the sense of moving from one place and or status to another. Or you can be displaced if you haven't moved, but the place around you has changed fundamentally, so you still feel displaced, even though you physically haven't relocated. But then I'd also like to encourage you to think about place and placement in terms of changing places. The places that change, but also how we change places as we move from one discipline to another. Anyone, I think, who practice or is engaged with refugee history has to acknowledge that other disciplines have brought so much to bear upon the subject. Social sciences, anthropology, political science, sociology, cultural theory, and so on. So one has to work oneself to change place. And then finally, you could see a statement made by a woman called Ristavkina, about whom I know nothing other than her name, but who wrote this in 1915. Not so long ago, these people, refugees, lived a full and independent working life. They had the right to be just like us, indolent, rude, ungrateful. Now they have lost this prerogative. Their poverty and helplessness oblige them to be meek and grateful, to smile at people they don't like, to answer each and every question, to submit to the authority of people they don't respect and have no wish to know. And when I read that and reread it, I thought, here is a voice speaking from over a century ago in ways that still resonate today. Thank you very much.